All right, you may be seated. I want to welcome all of you here today, this family and friends of Marvel Sadler. And as we celebrate her life today, I don't know about you, but I'm in shock. We weren't supposed to be here, were we? No one really saw this coming. Yes, she did have a weak heart. Yes, she was older, but she just moved to Huntington Manor a few weeks ago. Last time I saw her, I was driving by on 64th Avenue, just half a block from where she was staying, and she was walking down to the bus stop. Yeah, the bus stop. 90 years old, still taking the bus. She had courage, she had life. She was smiling. I think she was enjoying her new place and the freedoms that came along with that. Last time I visited her was in her new place. She wanted me to come and see it. And we brought along a Nigerian team that has been helping in our church. And she just welcomed them into her place, and she was showing everybody around. She was proud of her new place. And the last time I talked to her, she wanted to see if I could help her put up some pictures. She was making it her new home. And one of the things I loved about Marvel was the countless people, many of you, that she helped. She was always helping people all over the place, many that I didn't know anything about. And what I found very quickly that helping people seemed to be her greatest joy. She could be having a bad day. She could be having dizzy spells and sleepless nights, her heart struggling, stress. She'd be crying. And then she would talk about somebody that she was in the middle of helping. And you could start to see that spark come back to her eyes. The tears would fade and the joy would lift her spirits. She really was a servant to other people. And many of you have stories about Marvel that maybe the family doesn't know about. And I want to encourage you to share some of those stories over the next little while, whether it's afterwards when we're eating together or in the months to come. But I would encourage you to share some of those stories about how Marvel had an impact on your life. I was just talking to Brian Cross. He was sad he couldn't make it here today. He was telling me he probably knew her the longest because he was there at Ernie and Marvel's wedding. Played, I don't know, the piano or the organ at their wedding. And he was sad he could not make it here today. So keep those memories in mind and share them with each other. I find that sharing those memories gives us strength through the tough times we're all going through right now. Cornell Van Eyck, another pastor, is going to come. He knew Marvel for many years, and he's going to come and read scriptures and pray with us.
I'm honored to be part of this service today. I'm honored to meet the family. You know, we go to church and we meet people, but we don't realize behind every person, there's usually another person. And this is evidence of it. I too believe that Marvel was specially gifted by God. Her desire was always to be there for people, to serve people. And the sad part is, we don't always realize that whatever we do, is not appreciated, which is not true. We just don't talk about it because we feel awkward. I loved her. She had a special place in my heart. I spent afternoons, as Bernie can well attest to, at a home for a cup of tea or coffee and a sandwich. When I was going through a difficult time when my wife passed away or was suffering, I could always call on her. Marfa was always there. Even when she wasn't feeling that good herself. And she was faithful to the calling of God. She had a calling upon her life. And she was always willing and wanted to fulfill that calling. You know there are mixed feelings, I know that. I remember when my wife passed away, I felt that people really didn't care. People in the church, by the way, I'm a pastor, emeritus. That means that they honor me as a good man, a good pastor, good whatever. Don't always believe that. It's a title to give you and tell you, now you're retired. Now you go to green pastures. Well, a pastor is never finished doing what he was called to do. But one thing, when I was on the other side, not a pastor necessarily, but the one receiving or needing help, I often blamed the church. I blamed the pastor. The church wasn't there when my wife, when I needed them. They were there, silently praying, and a hope, especially for the family and friends. If there's any kind of feeling of, was the church really there for her? Believe me, she was the church. And God was there for her, which was more important. And Ernie, I spent days with you. I always wanted his car, his red Corvette, Mustang. Well, I didn't get it, unfortunately. I would have loved to have it. I couldn't afford it. But you know, when we hear, remembering her life and testimony that she left behind, the Lord was always aware of the necessity of us knowing that no matter what happens, we're never alone. And it's more important that we know and we realize that God is on our side than a particular person or a church. We tend to overlook the fact that church is not made up of sinners, of saints, but of sinners. We all have a need. But you know, the Lord's realizing the necessity of his presence, wrote, "I am the resurrection and the life, and he who believes in me shall live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." And then he remembered those who need a comfort. And Jesus said, "Come unto me, all who are weak, heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and leave and learn from me. For I am the gentle and humble in heart, and you shall find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, we've come together here this morning or this afternoon to remember and to celebrate the life of Marvel. Marvel right now is in glory. It's not in a bottle. She's in glory. She's in glory with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And tears have a place here because our lives are poorer for her loss. On the other hand, our sorrow is not unrelieved, because we know that because of Marvel, we have much to celebrate and remember with gratitude. And even though we know that death is inevitable, we all have to die, the reality of when it does come leaves us reeling. However, we know that she is, or has now, found victory over death. See, Marvel is no longer a person that at times in her weaknesses displayed an element of loss, of defeat, wondering what's happening. Well, she found victory over death in a Savior, Jesus Christ. And we need to be clear that our tears that we may shed today, or have shed, or will shed, are for our loss, not for her loss. Because she is in a place where tears and death and sorrow will never touch her again. And the same God through whom Marvel has victory over death is present and available to each one of us, each one here today. He's there in our needs. And let us turn to God for comfort, strength, and guidance. Let's pray. Lord, you who are the God of mystery and hope, and we come before you today carrying all the diverse needs and longings, joys and sorrows that fill our hearts. And we pray that in this time together, you might truly honor Marvel's memory and your presence among us. Father, we come to you with many unanswered questions today, seeking peace, bowing before the mysteries that surround us. And I pray that you will meet us here, heal and comfort, strengthen and soothe us. Be with the family as they're going through this difficult time, and when everything seemed to be so great, so nice, all of a sudden, you call the home. And that's a struggle that we are facing. Why? Well, I know one thing for sure, that Marvel is where she was hoping to go eventually. And she's now in glory, celebrating with the Lord. And if you, a family especially, think you got rid of this member, this mother, grandmother, I believe that she's still watching over each one of you and holding you close. Father, I pray that you will deal with us, with the family, in whatever ambivalence or anxiety we find ourselves in this moment. And grant your blessing upon us in the name and for the sake of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. See, the body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor and is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, but it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, but it is raised a spiritual body. Now, if there is a natural body, there's also a spiritual body. And I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, let me tell you a mystery. We will not all fall asleep like Martha did, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the blinking of an eye. We'll be changed at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. Now, when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and a mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? May God and his blessing to the reading of his word.
Anyone that knew Marvel knew that she loved music very much. She used to play the piano. She used to have a beautiful singing voice. She was just a marvel. We just loved her so much. And I'm very honored to be able to sing for this service this afternoon, and the pieces that I'm singing are ones that Marvel selected. So sit back and enjoy them. There's no one great among us, we're nothing on our own. We make mistakes and often slip, just common flesh and bones. But I'll prove prove someday just what I say. I'm of a special kind. When he was on the cross, I was on his mind. The look of love was on his face. The thorns were on his head. The blood was on his scarlet robe and stained a crimson red. And though his eyes were on the crowd that day, he looked ahead in time. 'Cause when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. He knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. So unworthy of such mercy, yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. Yet when he was on the cross, on his mind. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind.
Thanks, Vic. Alicia's going to come and share the eulogy now.
Thank you. Before we begin, I just want to say a quick thank you to everyone that could be here. Today we gather to celebrate the remarkable life of my grandma, Marvel Hope Sadler, a woman of immense strength, dedication, and love. Marvel Hope Lutit's journey began on April 5th, 1934, in Winnipeg, Manitoba. In 1937, she was adopted into a warm, bustling family that had already raised six children, Anne, Isabel, Ruth, John, Roberta, and Patricia, three of whom were already in university. Marvel's early years were marked by resilience. She faced the heart-wrenching loss of her mother while in grade 10, an experience that shaped her strength and determination. After finishing school, Marvel moved to Montreal to live with her sister Isabel and began working in banking. Her adventurous spirit led her west to Calgary, where she attended the Baptist Leadership Training School, BLTS. It was here that she met a wonderful group of friends and embarked on many great adventures. In 1962, Marvel married and became Marvel Hope Sadler. Together with her husband, Ernie, they began a family, raising their children, Robert, born in 1964, and Jennifer, born in 1967, with love and care. Marvel was determined to provide a better life for her family. Despite the challenges, she decided to pursue a bachelor's degree in education at the University of Calgary, while raising her children and working weekends at a jewelry store. Her dedication paid off when she secured a teaching job with the Calgary Board of Education even before graduating. She would complete her final course at night school, all while balancing the demands of her family and career. Marvel's passion for teaching was unparalleled. She made lasting impressions on countless students and their parents, many of whom kept in touch with her over the years. She had a special love for music and cherished the opportunities to share this passion with her students. Her friend, Brian Cross, provided many opportunities for her to sing, which she deeply appreciated. Marvel was a planner and adventurer at heart. She organized many memorable summer vacations for her family, exploring new places and creating cherished memories. I can say it's where my love of Grand Beach came from when she would take myself and my brother to Winnipeg to visit the aunties during the summer. Or my graduation trip, she planned where we went to Ottawa, Montreal, and Toronto. From Ottawa, we took a bus to Montreal, and from Montreal to Toronto, we took a train. In retirement, she continued to live life to the fullest, volunteering, helping others, and even working at her daughter's garden store on Wednesdays. She took day trips to some of the most obscure places in and around Calgary and southern Alberta, always on the go and eager for new experiences. One of those trips was a mini vacation she took myself and my brother on to Cardston, Fort McLeod, and Head Smashed In Buffalo Jump. When the time came to move to an independent living apartment, Marvel faced the decision with the same grace and determination that defined her life. Though she loved her home deeply, she knew it was time for a change. She enjoyed her new surroundings, but often made trips back to her house, a place filled with half a century of memories. Marvel's life was a testament to her strength, dedication, and unwavering love for her family and community. Her legacy will live on in the hearts of those she touched, from her family and friends to the many students whose lives she shaped. As we bid farewell to Marvel Hope Sadler, let us remember her with love and gratitude for the incredible life she led. Her spirit, kindness, and dedication will continue to inspire us all. Rest in peace, Grandma. You will be deeply missed and forever cherished.
Thanks, Alicia. Now, Robert and Jennifer, her children, are going to share some tributes.
Wow, she knew a lot of people. Hadn't turned around. My story today starts as we were young. We didn't have much. In fact, back in the day when there was a phone booth on every corner, the dime was at the back door for whoever left. Just in case something happened, they could call home. Things were tight. But it was my mom that made it work. For me, sometime in grade school, I decided skiing was the cool thing to do. We certainly did not have any money to send me skiing, but she did anyway. She put me in lessons over Christmas and so on, and skiing has been something that has just been a passion of mine my whole life. Not too long ago, her and I were having a conversation out in the garage about gardening crap or something. Too many planters hanging on the wall, I think. But I took a minute and said, you know what, Mom? I know you couldn't do it, but somehow you did. And you put me on that mountain. And I just want to say thank you for giving me that gift for my whole life. Because now it's something that has just been a thrill to share with my G daughter. Because about when she was five, we had a very, very serious conversation about the things you can do during winter, because winter's going to come, so you might as well enjoy it. And skiing was one of the things she decided she wanted to try. And I have to say, she's doing a great job. This last year, we went up the big mountain for the first time, and she killed it. Had a couple of good spills and ate some snow, but she never got discouraged. She always sat down and just thought about, you know, how she could do better the next time, and she's she's really coming along, and I hope it sticks with her the way it stuck with me. So, but that was my mom, generous. Even when she couldn't, she was generous. Thank you.
I'd like to thank all of you for coming today. I understand life can be busy, and I really appreciate you taking the time. Special thank you to my cousin Irene, who dropped everything to fly in. My dear friends, Henry and Lawrence. Henry, thank you. You were there in the first hours, and you've repeatedly said, I can be there in 15 minutes. What do you need? All week. Joseph, who went to great lengths to fly in from LA this morning. Ed and Allison Tomlinson, who are here from the UK, and we're supposed to have lunch with my mom today. And thank you to those who drove in from out of town. Known for her incredible energy, passion for teaching, and unwavering love for family, friends, and community, my mom was a fine example of living each day fully. One thing that always impressed me was how she embraced retirement. Though she's always said she would have kept teaching forever, she didn't let that stop her from making the most of each day. After she passed, I was feeling regret for not having her over more often for lunch or coffee or to enjoy my yard and home. But then I remembered she was busy. She was doing a lot of stuff. She volunteered extensively, and one of her efforts was with the Sir Optimist International, a global organization that provides women and girls with access to education and training for economic empowerment. It seems fitting that she would devote her time to helping others who struggled as she did early on. My mom was always about lifting others up and making a difference. One of the events she invited me to annually was the Blue Jean Bonanza at Heritage Park. She would call me the minute she got the tickets and make sure I marked the date on my calendar. It was held at the Wainwright Hotel. We'd have dinner, a glass of wine, and then be handed a fistful of phony money to go and gamble. Now, this wasn't something I thought she would enjoy, but I was very wrong. After that glass of wine, she lit up those gambling tables, and I always teased her she was putting a little too much fun back in fundraising. Another and perhaps even greater passion in retirement was being a White Hatter. She volunteered with them for 18 years until COVID put a stop to that. It was truly her calling. I remember our volunteer activities would overlap sometimes at the airport. I volunteered with a local rescue doing customs brokering for flights of dogs we would bring in. Whenever she was working and we arrived with the crates, she'd be running through the airport at 80, telling her White Hatter friends, the rescue dogs are here. We always gathered quite a crowd because of her enthusiasm. Even when she wasn't volunteering, her and my dad would come to the airport to watch the dogs arrive and the volunteers pick up their fosters. One flight, I had a foster, this chubby 6-year-old dog that had been surrendered because her owner wanted to travel. My parents adopted her immediately, and that dog could not have known the jackpot she hit. She was doted on daily and showered with love and attention from that moment on. When I was helping pack some things for her new apartment, there was a bin with an unfinished quilt in it. And she said she needed to bring it because her quilting teacher was coming to help her finish it. She was a lifelong learner. And that impressed me very much. Her life was filled with wonderful moments and memories. She was a teacher, a volunteer, a friend, grandma and mom to my brother and me. She made lasting impressions on those she met, from her students to her family and even those lucky enough to cross paths with her in various volunteer roles. As we say goodbye, let's remember Marvel's vibrant spirit and her dedication to helping others. Her legacy will live on in the things we do to honor it. Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer and Robert. Amazing lady. I've been Marvel's pastor here for the last 12 and a half years. One of the problems with knowing one of your congregants for that long is she found her way not just into our congregation, but into my heart and became a friend. And as I got to know her, I found over and over again that one of the main things that drove her was that she could simply use her resources to help other people. If there was something that she no longer needed and her kids didn't want, she would find somebody who could use it. If she saw someone in need, she would help them. I know there are people here that's probably been helped for decades because of her, long before my time. And she was passionate. I know right from the beginning when I met her that her relationship with her husband Ernie was rocky at times. I saw the fire in her eyes. At the same time, she loved him dearly. She was passionate about her relationship, and she cared for him. And when the time came where she could no longer care for him herself, she cried many tears over the thought of him going somewhere. And when eventually it came time to find a home for him, she was not happy with just any place. It had to be the right place. And when he finally went to his new home, she made sure that things were lined up for him. His laundry was done. He had his TV, his bed, and many other things. She cared. And she would often look back with fondness at her years as a teacher and the different students that had been special. She looked back with fondness, as Jennifer shared, in her years as a White Hatter. And she really built a community there where she would often phone some of them when she was going through difficult times. And she especially loved you, her family. I've heard many conversations about Robert's accomplishments, about Jennifer's accomplishments, Alicia, and others in the family. She was fiercely proud of you all. And she loved Jesus, into whose arms she now rests. She was an avid reader, and she turned to her devotional books and the Word of God to find solace and comfort when life was tough. So let me just share a few verses from God's Word, which she always kept by her bed, on her bed, so that maybe we can find some peace and comfort for this time of difficult loss. Psalm 116 says this: "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. Truly I am your servant, Lord. I serve you just as my mother did. You have freed me from my chains. I will sacrifice the thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, Jerusalem. Praise the Lord." Apparently, it seems that the Lord takes special note of one of his own that passes on from this life. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. The word servant is mentioned two or three times in that passage. And the scriptures tell us that service is part of our DNA, the way we've been created in order to thrive. And when we learn to do this, we seem to enjoy life better. Even Jesus said, I didn't come here to be served, but to serve, and then to give my life in exchange for the many of you that are held hostage. And the reason so many of us are here today is because she touched us all, and often as a servant. There's something about a servant that speaks to their love for us. When they don't demand things in return, when they find joy in you being helped, when they don't selfishly keep it to themselves, as our world seems to teach. Jesus also said in one of his stories, as he explained the reason for the story, he says, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. And she took that seriously. In fact, there was a lot of people probably don't even know how much she did for you, for them. And what Jesus was hinting at was the fact that when we serve others, because of the strength we find in Jesus, we're actually doing it to Jesus himself without even knowing it sometimes. And what I love about God is that he is far more proud of us for what we do for others than whether we can preach or have all the right degrees behind our name. One thing I found out about Marvel is she is an incredibly smart person. She was proud of her heritage. She helped a lot of people figure things out, write letters for other people, help them through things. Maybe she didn't have a ton of degrees. She wasn't a preacher, but she did what she could to help other people. She knitted, she sewed, she shared books, cards, she decorated, she played the piano, and she constantly gave. And because of that, today, Jesus has called her home. And I can imagine at those pearly gates in heaven that the warm hands of a loving, gracious Savior welcoming her into this continued, everlasting, deepening friendship with the words, well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. See, heaven is not about sitting around on clouds or for an exhausting eternity. It's not about sitting alone in our mansions reflecting on our blip of life forever. Jesus said, come on in and let's celebrate together. Because Jesus is about love and grace and friendship and being together. When he was excited to tell his own disciples, which, by the way, he called friends as they moved in that relationship, he was excited to tell them about the place that he was going to prepare for them. When they were worried about where he was going after he left them, he said, don't worry about it, because I'm going to prepare lots of rooms in this house. And it's interesting, he doesn't tell them about the square footage of this new place. He doesn't tell them about the latest innovations of air conditioning or something, which we could really use today. No, the only thing that Jesus talks about this place, listen to what he says. John 14 says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and then take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. What does that tell you? It tells me that the excitement of looking up to heaven is not about real estate, but in real relationship. Deep relationship, authentic relationship, where love goes on and on forever and deeper and deeper. And one of the hardest things about today is you start building a relationship with somebody like Marvel, and as it goes deeper, all of a sudden it's cut off. And we feel the pain of it because we expect, our instinct says that love should keep going on and get deeper. And today, Marvel is free from her dizzy spells, her sleepless nights, the palpitations of a weak heart, her sensitive ears at times, and everything else. And today, her joy is not in running into a hollow mansion, but in seeing her sisters and parents, her friends, her Savior, her gracious Heavenly Father. And the only reason she was able to give to so many of us was because of the strength she found in her Savior, through the Jesus she came to know as a young person. She was small in stature, but she was huge in stature as a servant to many. And I think if Marvel was standing here today, she would tell us to get to know Jesus, to look past hers and our flaws and as a broken human beings to the Savior who gave her joy, gave her strength, that filled her with hope. I mean, it was her middle name, Hope. That gave her the wisdom to navigate all the tough stuff of life that kept her focused through the tough times. And so today, as we are grieving the loss of a lady that snuck her way into our hearts, let's turn our attention upwards to a Heavenly Father who loves us, where Marvel is dancing and singing and maybe playing a piano, free from tears, free from a weak heart that took her, free from all the concerns and all the changes that stressed us here, to find our strength in a heavenly home that takes us into the loving, perfect relationship with Jesus forever. Amen. Vic's going to come and sing for us again. I know who holds tomorrow.
Flame or flood, but his presence goes before me, and I'm covered with his blood. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand.
Just in closing, we're going to stand together and let's sing Because He Lives, one of her favorites, as Vic leads us. Just stay standing as we pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, as we remember Marvel Hope Sadler, you are here with us with your love and grace and comfort through the blessed hope of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. And so we now commit the earthly body of Marvel Sadler into your loving care. We do this with love and respect, in appreciation for her and what she meant to all of us. Give each one here today, especially her family, her kids, comfort and strength for the days ahead as we mourn her loss. I pray that the memories of Marvel will remind us of our need of that deep, loving relationship with Jesus that she so enjoyed. We commit her spirit into the care and keeping of a just and merciful God. We pray this in the precious name of the one who gave his life for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now to him who is able to keep us, to strengthen us according to the gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that has kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed through the prophetic writings, has been made known to all nations, according to the command of God, to bring about the obedience of faith, to only a wise God be glory forever and ever through Jesus Christ. Amen. I encourage you to join us for a luncheon afterwards. We'll stay standing as the family is dismissed first, and then we can all join in the fellowship hall afterwards. And again, encourage you to share some memories and care for the family.